manage your own expectations also. Having said that, in stock markets, around 1990s, we were basically doing risk management by accident. Then you trade, and somewhere you do settlements, and then somewhere along the line, somebody defaults. If he defaults, people die, so what do you do, right? You cry about it and go and sort of clean it up and start living your life, right? That was risk management by accidents. And then somewhere on the line, we started thinking in 1990s, which is what we call liberalized zone of India, where we started thinking very systematically about what are the risks, and we had one of the largest risks for paper risk. We used to have physical certificates, and the technology had moved so much of printing paper that everyone was printing share certificates at their home. Instead of company share certificates issuing, people were sort of printing certificates and giving out, and it was supposed to be a fake delivery or forced delivery and so on and so forth. And instead of printing currency, which is a criminal offense, and government takes very serious offense at that because it's their own currency. But when you print certificates, it is actually much larger in value and nobody bothered. So we had to actually manage that risk by setting up depositories. So depositories were set up as a part of managing the paper risk of India. And then we had another issue of people defaulting. There was a great default for MS Shoes. I don't know whether you've heard of a Delhi company called MS Shoes. On that stock, some people actually created huge positions and they defaulted. And that opened our eyes to the default risk, which is a very large risk, especially when you need to have contracting happening with anonymous parties in stock markets. When you trade in Jammu with somebody in Chennai, you don't know either party. If one of them fails, the contract is not fulfilled. And how do you make the contract fulfilled? And that's how clearing corporations were set up to become guarantors. And they manage their risks by various models. One of them is called value at risk model. It's very simple if you sort of go into the details. But effectively, we have several models of extreme value theory and so on and so forth. But we set up the clearing corporations and we measure portfolio-based risks and so on and so forth. That in next one day, 24 hours, how much the portfolio can potentially lose. On that basis, we take margins, initial margins, mark-to-market margins, and so on and so forth, and we manage the risk. So effectively, from 1995 onwards, in 2014, around 1920 years, we have had very few defaults, and even if there were defaults, we had basically ability by the clearing operation, their funds created, to ensure that even if one party defaults, the counterparties actually are paid off by the clearing operations. And that is how we have tried to manage the risk like an insurance, a collective insurance of all the brokers by the clearing operations. There are various ways to do things. Insurance is a pool mechanism where everyone puts in money into the pool, and then if somebody dies, their families get money and so on. So similarly, clearing corporations are in that sense what they call CCPs in technical terms. But there are again many situations. Automation has helped greatly. We have been able to implement many of these things through automations. And we also, unlike rest of the world, we manage the risk at a client level. In US, in Europe, in Japan, in all parts of the world, the stock exchanges and clearing corporations manage risk only at the clearing member level, that is banks who clear on behalf of customers on that basis. In India, because of regulations and regulator being very technology savvy, and they know that we have the ability to do it at the client level, they are forced us to do the risk management at client level. So we are far ahead of the rest of the world in terms of the risk management at exchanges. Our transaction processing system, that is a in-place order, as Kaushal said, we give you a response time in 200 microseconds. 1 second has 10 lakh microseconds, 1 million microseconds. We give you a response time in that 1/5000 of a second. And on that, I do risk management at portfolio level. And I have 2.65 crore investors registered with me. Anytime anyone of them pray, before they settle, I actually manage. And 2.65 crore looks very small from India's perspective, but if you were a country, if BSE was a country, it would be 24th largest country in the world. It is growing very fast. And somewhere around 2030-2035, if India progresses well, so people start investing more money into financial instruments, we may have, instead of 2.65 crores, we may have 26 crore investors. That would be basically making them, that will make us fourth largest country in the world. Having said that, there are several international issues which are coming up. ABI is one regulation, which is European regulation, which is regulating the clearing operations across the world. SEBI has its own regulation, which keep on changing all the time to make system more and more tighter, so that less risk is exposed in a sense. We have also added more instruments like interest rate futures, equity options, index futures, index options, and so on and so forth. And each of those instruments are basically allowing you to pass on the risk if you feel like, or take on more risk if you feel like. If you take on more risk, it is called speculation. If you pass on the risk, it is called hedging. But sometimes, when you think you are passing on the risk, you end up taking more risk. So sometimes you think you are hedging, but you are speculating. And we also obfuscate the issues, especially in financial markets. We have an ability to create jargons every day. So when we call a fund a hedge fund, it is actually a misnomer because it's a speculative fund. But if I call it speculative fund, then nobody will agree. So I call it a hedge fund. With that, thank you very much for listening to me.
Thanks, Ashish, for a wonderful perspective. I learned this lesson around standard deviation and risk very, very interestingly a couple of years ago, actually 3 years ago, when we were closing the year. We closed the year in November, very unique. We work on a December and November cycle. And for some reason, we had a fabulous November. I think it was some accounting entries got reversed, etc. So we ended up with what I would call quote a windfall profit in that particular, in that month. So when we reported the results, I thought, you know, there'll be bouquets and chocolates coming in from, you know, corporate headquarters. Instead, you know, we were all hauled up the coast, my CFO and I, saying, you know that any deviation above plus or minus 2%, plus 2% no eyes, but any deviation above plus or minus 2% needs a detailed explanation. Please come to New York and explain why your profits have increased by 14% this particular month than what you had predicted. Next thing you know, we're going there. What I thought would have been a victory lap turned out to be an exercise in explaining what really happened. For the next 2 months, I was dealing with that. And I'm not joking. This plus minus 2% is an article of faith for us. Rita, my colleague in the room, she knows that, you know, everything we measure, if anything goes above plus minus 2%, there has to be a detailed explanation on a weekly basis to why that happens. And this was my learning, which I wanted to share. But it comes from what Ashish said in terms of standard deviation. And just any deviation from the norm needs to be explained, whether positive or negative. So I just thought I would share that with you. Our next speaker for this morning is Dr. Badri Syed Bhandari, who is full-time member of the Pension Fund Regulatory Development Authority. He's been promoting old age income security by establishing, developing, and regulating pension funds, protecting the interests of subscribers to the scheme of pension funds, registration, supervision, monitoring of the intermediaries involved in the national pension system, analyzing the developments in the pension sector within as well as outside the country so that we can bring in best practices for expanding pension coverage in a sustainable and equitable manner in our country. He has a PhD from the University of Delhi, the Faculty of Management Studies, and an MBA from the University of Strathclyde, United Kingdom. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Badri Syed Bhandari.
Sector, but after hearing, I thought I'd just respond to some of the points made here, and let us see. Now, you know, it has been said that risk is inherent in any business, and risk is basically the variability in returns. Now, when it is inherent, it cannot be avoided. So, why not to manage it or mitigate it? And then, you know, in order to manage and mitigate it, you need to identify risk, like, you know, what it is it has been, you know, there have been many failures in the businesses, and it has been seen that more often than not, they were due to the liability side risk rather than the asset side risk. In the sense that, like, your asset side risk is, what are your businesses, where your assets are invested, whereas your liability side risk is, how are you financing your businesses? And whenever there are mismatches, it could be, you know, maturity mismatch, your funding is for short term, your investment are in long term, or your earnings are in foreign exchange, whereas, your earnings are in domestic currency, whereas your borrowings are in foreign exchange. So they need to risk, you know, maturity mismatch, currency mismatch, things like that. Now, it has been seen that more often than not, when the businesses went for very high leverage, that led to the failures of businesses. And there have been many cases. I have just noted down a few. In the mid-90s, there was a hedge fund called Long-Term Capital Asset Management in USA, which had 3 Nobel Prize winners on its board of directors, and they used to invest money basically government bonds, the US securities and the Japanese securities, and if the duration is saved, at some point of time, it can be calculated that they should come to the same return based on their expectation. And what they did, their expectation was such that they started taking a lot of money from the market and pumping that money into the differences, the earning differences, and as a result, it went bankrupt. It had to be paid out by Federal Reserves and a few other banks. Nick Leeson, you must have heard, the gentleman who brought the British Daring Bank to bankruptcy. There was one Orange County in USA, that it was completely watered down. Now, all this due to excessive leverage, and this leverage also not guided by the fundamentals, the earning fundamentals, but by more by the greed. Mr. Sampath mentioned about about volatility, unpredictability, uncertainty, complexity. Now, all these are leading to high risk. But say in India, what is happening is, you see the demand side, there is huge unmet demand both on the social sector, health, education, water, sanitation, nutrition, in physical infrastructure, your transportation, your power, your communication, and this demand is increasing. Number one, our population is increasing. Our per capita income is increasing. People's aspirations are increasing. With communication is, people are in a position to relate to, what is to the world market very quickly. So on the demand side, I don't think there is any risk. The businesses can always plan for the market. The market is, always upward, the positive side of the market. On the supply side, there are bottlenecks. And here is a challenge where the businesses have to accept. There are a lot of challenges, but this country is not it doesn't lack any resource. In fact, God has been very bountiful to give us almost every resource. I doubt whether there is any other country in the world which has as many resources as we have. Whether they are human resources, they are natural resources, they are mineral resources, the nature, the climate itself. So then the challenge is, how to mobilize these resources and use them for the benefit of the wider public. There were issues top 85% own half of the global GDP. And this is our challenge. Like, you know, in the sense that if a large section of people is have not, now, unless we put little more money in their pocket, we are not living in a happy situation. In the sense that, you know, I'm very rich, I have almost everything, but the vicinity I live in is not very neat and clean. Then I also, you know, it is my responsibility to see that, you know, it also becomes neat and clean. There has to be, like, you know, you see, I think just open any window, see 50 feet down the road to find that, you know, how people are living. So again, that is also our own responsibility. We have to ensure that, you know, it is not only me, my business, but the wider public. And here what had happened, like, you know, in case of the financial inclusion and financial awareness, there have been series of talks in different seminars, conferences. The very basis of nationalize the bank in 1969 first, then 1982 nationalization, priority sector lending, opening of more branches in rural areas, the very licensing policy of the branches, and, you know, priority sector advances. All, despite all that, even today, more than 50% of the farmers do not get credit. Now, have we done our due diligence in this case? What is happening? Like, on the business, you know that the savings for a society of Indian size and character, where the per capita income is about $1,500 per annum, we are saving one-third of our GDP, about 33% of our GDP we are saving. This is not a small amount. We are not very much dependent upon foreign investment. That doesn't mean that foreign investment is not necessary. It is necessary. We welcome it, and we must, you know, structure our systems and procedure that, you know, we welcome every penny that comes here. But the thing is, we have to set our house in order to, because most of our investment is from domestic saving. These savings are coming from the household sector. You know, the businesses and the government is not the saver. So basically, these people, like, you know, the channelizing the savings of the people, that has to be seen. What had happened in businesses, like, you know, there is something called credit creation. Businesses can get money from their assets, which need not necessarily be funded by their own money. They are funded from the public finances. They are funded by the household savings. But through the credit creation, the assets are bankable, create more money, create additional assets. Against them, get more money. Now, is it possible to have a similar system for people who are untouched by the formal banking system? Can we think of something that, you know, their assets become bankable? Now I'm speaking from the forum of a credit rating agency. And I don't think, you know, there can be a better opportunity than this one. You know, in USA, it is very common to go for a Chapter 11 filing, like, you know, people seek bankruptcy in order to get protection from their creditor. You know, this is very common. Whereas in this country, there is a stigma attached to indebtedness. The farmers commit suicide, you know, when they are not in a position to pay their debt. Should it not be counted as the integrity and honesty of the proprietor? Should we not have some weightages for this particular attribute of the fellow? Have you ever thought about these issues?